You're listening to the Drinks in a Movie podcast, hosted by Rudy Ruiz. Spoiler alert.
Drinks in a Movie podcast. Yo, what's up, everyone? Thank you for tuning in. We've got a new special episode here. I'm joined by co-host Matt once again.
I was going to ask, is this like a very special episode? Because there's like a ton of beverage on this table, folks.
It is special now. So we're going to be discussing Quentin Tarantino's eighth film from 2015, The Hateful Eight. This is one I've been wanting to do for a while. And for me, it's become kind of a Christmas season movie that I have to watch every December. And I'm like, man, okay, Hateful Eight. We got to do either some kind of eight-year-old expression or eight different bottles. And it dawned on me when I looked at my shelf that at this point, I've got eight different expressions of Nelson Brothers whiskey. Several of these, they sent to me in a care package a while back. So if you've been following the show, you know I've done like quick little reviews on them. And we've covered these all on episodes before.
Oh, wow.
So they have all been tackled already. But I've never done them all side by side like this. So I figured let's do a little blind tasting, the two of us. I poured the blinds and I wrote it down. But luckily, I feel like I already forgot what's what. Because that was a while ago. I was worried I would just know, but I think I forgot it. And then this will be completely fresh for you. You were in a different room when I was pouring and writing everything down. So just half ounce pour. So there's not a lot to sip from. So we
can actually talk through the podcast.
Because this is quite a bit.
Yeah.
So we'll try to be very concise with our notes and everything. I don't think we need to spend like a ton of time talking through the whiskey since we've already talked through them all. And there's a lot to talk about with the film itself. Right? We do got a 3-hour movie ahead of us. So anyway, so here we go. Let's dig in. So glass number one.
But just number one.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
We haven't warmed up or anything either, so this is
completely fresh.
Going in just for fun.
I better sip some water first, actually. I do really like this nose. Shit.
Yeah, the nose is really good.
Man, it's sweet. I can't like pinpoint the flavors, but it's definitely on the sweeter side, man.
Yeah. I'm kind of...
Maybe a little fruit forward?
Kind of this... Well, maybe. I can't remember what some of these... So it's been a while since I've had any of these folks.
Yeah.
And when I say a while, I think the last time I had the Nelson Brothers was a month or two.
When we recorded The Thing, that's when we opened up the cognac finish. Oh, so that was probably...
Right, that's right. It was the cognac.
Okay, now that must have been like 2-3 weeks ago.
Yeah,
now.
Yeah. So that one was within a month. But did you bring one of these over when we were beveraging at Eric's house for some reason?
The sour mash. That's like almost finished.
Gotcha.
Yeah, here we go.
Okay.
That's nice. I feel like it's... I feel like it's kind of grapey.
Definitely
really nice.
A little bit, a tad of the sweetness.
Yeah. Grapey, kind of buttery on the palate, like that nice oily texture, a little bit of that caramel, but like on the finish.
I love the nose on this one, man. It's like, sometimes my nose doesn't work because I got so many different allergies and shit, but like this is going right in there, really nice.
Yeah, that's really, this is, okay, so we're off to a really damn good start.
Yeah, I'm like, dude, that's the way to start.
Okay, number one, so it's currently in first place.
It's a little bit. Are all these over 100 proof?
No, they all range from like 90 to 124. Okay, something like that.
Oh, there you go. Yeah, that's one. I'm gonna pose number one right now.
Yeah, that was good. Okay, number two.
Damn, we just go right into it.
Okay. I feel like this one's also a little fruit forward. Maybe even more so.
Yes, that it's less heat on this one in the nose, at least for me. Yeah, I'm getting a tad more.
Now it's getting kind of mellow. All right, here we go.
Cheers.
Oh man, ooh, I like that a lot. Damn, that's good.
That one's pretty thick and rich. I'm pretty confident I know exactly what that is, but I'm not going
to
say it.
This one gets, I don't know the way to say it, but I got more of the flavors throughout the whole tongue this time. And I don't, maybe it's just the way I sipped the first one. That's one thing I always never know too, is like, is that just because I was like cleansing my palate with number one? But this one is similar, but just got, it has a little bit more, I don't know if spice isn't the right word, but there's just a tad more flavor on this one that I'm getting at least. Once again, folks, I don't trust my taste buds worth a damn. So just would.
I do like it. I can't pick out anything specific, and it's got a little more depth of flavor. It's more richness. It dries me out a little more, too. I'll tell you that.
I was just getting that
a little
right
more drying.
So that means
I'm going to put that. I should have left the bottles turned around because I feel like now you're trying to figure it out. Let's see. I'm still going to put number one ahead of number two.
I'm in the same boat, I think. Let me take one more sip.
And I'm not finishing mine because I want to like go back and do them all again.
Oh, got it. Okay.
I mean, you can do it how you want, but because I want to go back and like reference them.
Yeah, I think I like one better than two as well. I'm going to agree with that.
So I think for me, for now, I do have notes here, but I'm going to decipher mine by putting one further back. We'll do two right there.
That is intense. Okay. No, I can't. I'm good.
All right, here we go. Glass three.
I think you got a right idea. I think just taking a little sip and then coming back to it.
Yeah. It's a lot more muted for me.
Muted.
Like definitely not as strong. What does this remind me of, dude? There's like a specific flavor I'm like nosing here.
Oh, it's
making me think of like a taffy candy, like a grape or cherry taffy, like thick gummy sticky candy of some sort. I can't be specific, but
I'm kind of on the same boat as you.
Something like that.
It's just it's not nearly as strong as the other two. At least coming off right in it.
All right, here we go. Glass three.
Okay. I think I know which one that is.
Oh, yeah?
No, maybe not. It's totally different.
So that one is considerably lighter, a little thinner on the palate, just lighter all around. But I feel like that quintessential, like, caramel note.
Yeah, yeah.
Like, totally. Bourbon caramel note. But, muted. It matches the nose in that. It's, like, just a little too soft for me right now.
I agree. Especially when you have so much punch in the first two that we tasted. It's funny how much that plays a factor in, like, because had you not had that beforehand, I'm not sure. I mean, you would have been able to tell, but
that's why I like to save a little sip so that I can go back.
Yeah, I think I'm gonna definitely my third favorite, but I'm gonna
right now for me, and I think we're the same. Yeah. Like 1, 2, 3is literally like the order of placement right now for me. Then, all right, glass one, still the one to beat. Here we go, glass number four. Can't really get past maybe a little of like a nutmeg. Like it definitely has a more spicier vibe.
Definitely does not have the sweetness that one and two had in the nose. So I think peppery is probably the right way to call it.
There you go, glass four. All right, that's good. The moment it hit my tongue, I was like, oh, I know which one this is. I know which one this is. I'm not going to say it.
Yeah. Oh, that's good, man.
That one's really good. Right off the moment it hit my tongue, I was like, oh yeah, I like feel the flavors, and I think that spice note is really nice. It still has
very
that
well
sweetness.
Balanced.
Yeah.
Very well balanced.
So this one, I think I'm gonna boost this up to second place now.
Dude, you literally took my the thing that I liked a little bit better about the first one is it lasted a little bit longer on the tongue. This one faded pretty quickly, but it's not drying me out like number two did. So I was going to put it in second place as well because I really, the flavor right on top is super good.
Yeah.
But it's not staying with me as long as number one did.
I think for me, the finish is really nice. Like I think it's sticking around for me.
Oh, nice.
There's a lot of spice on the finish. I think it kind of matches number one in it's that close. Regard. Like the flavor is definitely different. I'll try them together in a minute, but glass four is second place now.
Glass four, yeah, same here. Jeez Louise, dude. I swear I'm not trying to copy him. Before I even assumed that tasted, I'm like, this is the second.
Yeah, that was a really nice one because like the moment it hit the tongue, it was especially right compared to glass number three. Okay, so what do you get on the nose of this one?
More vanilla.
Vanilla?
Yeah. Nope. Almost like, hang on a sec. Thought it was vanilla. It's not. Something, it's a sweetness.
I get sour candy, like sour punch straws. If you open a pack, like the little gummy strings with the sour sugar on it. That's all it smells like to me.
To me, it smells like, I was actually a little less sweet than that, like banana runs kind of thing. But
Okay. Well.
Or banana-ish. Hmm. But I know banana is not normally a flavor you associate with this stuff. But
I mean, it is. I pick it up is. In this, I've never called banana. I call it, pretty much everyone calls banana a lot in Jack Daniels. That's like a common note
for interesting.
Their products.
Okay.
Old Foresters, I'll get it in sometimes. I can kind of see that. Like when you say that, I can kind
of. I'm trying to think of a better one, but that, like either a banana or banana, like a fake banana, like banana runs, you know?
Yeah, right. That's a good note.
Okay.
All right, here we go. That's another one that's super light. Like, I may put that. I'm pretty confident I know what that one is, and I may actually put that in front of number three. I'm gonna try number three again.
Really? Yeah, I've kind of. Oh man, I'm gonna put this one actually in last, but only because it's so much lighter. So,
yeah,
I've learned as I'm getting older here. I tend to like stuff with
more
bit,
proof. Yeah.
More, you know, stronger, taste to it, a little bit hotter and things like that. And this definitely doesn't have that. It's not a negative thing on the beverage itself. It's just not my cup of tea, you know?
So everyone's different.
Yeah.
And then that's the thing with the orders too, right? Because it's like we said before, if you start with something that's super high proof,
that's true too.
And then the next glass you have is like very low, then by comparison, it's like, oh, well, this isn't that, you know?
Right. I want to compare 3 and 5. I'm going to leave, but this one's in my last place right now. But I'll compare them at the end, see if I switch them around.
Yeah, they're kind of close. I was almost going to swap 3 and 5 right now, but.
It's funny. Even in the taste, I was still getting a tad of that banana for some reason.
I think I'll keep 5 and last right now, too. Okay. So currently, I think we're the same.
Yeah.
Last place is 5.
Mm-hmm.
Fourth place is 3.
Mm-hmm.
Third place is 2.
Correct.
Second place is 4.
Yep.
And then first place is 1. Okay. Glass 6.
Oh, shit.
You all right?
Put it in my nose. Oh, fuck. I did it.
You'll burn your nostrils out.
Oh, just a little bit. Oh, man. sorry, folks. That's the first time that's happened. We're using shot glasses, so.
For the last couple.
Yeah.
I already had so many Glencairns. I need to get more.
No, I hate to give away your secret and everything, but like, I did. Can't stick my nose the same way. Oh, folks, cut me off.
So this one's a little more on the spicy side. Like, what was that? 4 had that big spice note. This has another big peppery spice note with a little bit of a.
But if there's
some kind of fruit
character. Yeah, there's a hint of sweetness in there, but not as strong as like, you know, number 1 and 4.
Almost a little perfumey though. Ooh, in a weird way. Like not bad, but
But you know, you might call it florally or something like that. You know.
That's good. That's actually good right there. Floral. All right, here we go. Glass 6. So that for me is going to immediately go to 4th place for sure.
Ooh, I might put mine up higher than that. I feel like it's a good balance between, it feels like it's almost like the bridge between something that's a little bit stronger to something that's a little less stronger.
Yeah, it really is. Man, it has that nice like buttery kind of caramel note on the back palate and the finish like the other ones did, but started with a lot of spice.
I would take
up front.
I'm going to guess on this one when we get there.
Okay.
But I'm actually putting that in 3rd place for me.
So in 3rd?
Our first time, yeah. I liked it better than...
I'll taste it one more time.
Because
actually, no, I'll keep it here because I want to like leave enough to go back.
I feel like that's also like a good... it could be... I get the feeling that that could be your go-to. You know, you could share that with friends.
I was thinking along the same area. Yeah. I'm not going to say which one.
Yeah, okay, so we might think it's probably the same one then.
But yeah, I have that same thought.
Okay.
All right. Glass number 7. Here we go.
This one, folks, I'm not going to dump up my nostrils like a freaking amateur.
Man, so for me, the last 2 are in the shot glasses, and it's like significantly harder to get the...
Yeah. Okay. I feel less like a...
I see, like, because now I see why you
accidentally...
Because I feel like I'm about to do that. I don't know. I mean, it's hard to tell. Again, I'm not in the Glencairn. It seems like it's not that different from glass 6.
I would agree with that.
So far, it seems very, very similar. So here we go, glass 7.
Oh, it definitely tastes different.
Yeah.
Ooh.
Ooh.
Oh, that's good. Ooh, I like this one a lot. Yeah, this is super good.
Ooh. That's a really nice one. Does that...
Damn.
Dang, where does that go now?
For me, it's either 2nd or 3rd place, and I don't know which one. It's definitely going ahead of the last one we had. Oh, it's so good. It's staying with me. Oh,
yeah, I think I might put it ahead of the last one too, maybe.
Damn, that's good. This is so...
I'm going to do it right now. I'm going to compare it to 6.
It's kind of wild. This is my first time doing a blind tasting like this. And so like the fact that this is all coming from the same place, like is just literally blowing my mind that they have that different, flavor palettes, flavor profiles.
I might, you know, I think I'm still going to keep 6 ahead of it, but I am going to move this up to 5th place.
Okay, I'm going to put it ahead. It goes into my 3rd place.
Like it's weird because I think it may have had.
I'm going to have to compare those two because it could go into 2nd place. I think it's that good.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I'm still, I might swap it. Let me compare it with 2 real quick.
There you go. Could be changing on the move right now.
2, I'm still going to keep in 3rd, I think.
Okay.
Man, 6 and 7. All right, let me hold on that for a second. Because I think six had a little more punch and spice to it on the front, which I liked. But seven, my ultimately, it's lighter, but may have had better flavor. So it's like, right now, what of those do I value more? You know,
yeah.
Like right now, if you were to tell me, like, whichever one you pick, I'm going to pour you another shot of that. Like, which one of those in this moment do I want?
God.
And it might be the one with more front.
Dude, when you say that, man, that makes me want to move. Okay, we're going to compare. That's a great way to approach it, though. Like, okay, what are you finishing off with? You know,
yeah.
Like what are you asking for your second beverage? What do you have in second place, then? What number is in second place for you?
Number four.
Okay, so one and two are still the same for you and I.
Yeah.
That's probably just a preference.
So I guess we'll recap real quick. So for me, sixth place, number five.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Fifth place, number three.
Yep, same here.
Four. Wait, hold on. Seventh place was number five.
Yeah.
Sixth place, number three. Fifth place, number seven for me.
Ooh, this is where we differ.
Right. And then, because that's the one that might move up. Fourth place, number six for me.
Okay.
Third place, number two.
Okay.
Second place, number four.
Okay.
And then first place, one.
So we definitely have some differences. So I'm 5-3. We're in the same last places. But in fifth place, I got number two. And then I got 6-7-4-1. Okay. So we share number six, but seven most definitely is a different place. So it's interesting. So it's gone a little different.
Yeah.
So, okay.
All right. Glass number eight.
Beware of the shot glasses. Man,
yeah. Another one that's hard to nose. I can't even tell. I'm just going to sip it.
Yeah. It's at this point.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, literally, I have whiskey up my nose, so
that's good. That's nice. I mean,
dude, okay,
I wish I could nose it though, because that probably would enhance it if we knew what it smelled like, you know.
Okay, we had talked about, I think, either number six being like maybe one of the more approachable ones. This seems super approachable.
Yeah.
Like, this is very, very well balanced.
Yeah.
There's not a ton of heat up front, but it's got a really full finish, and that's the way I best way I can say it. It feels like you're getting a full flavor throughout the entire tongue, in my opinion.
And so, that's important.
Yeah, damn, where would I put that? I might put that ahead of number six. Oh man, that's close. It's definitely either behind six or number six. Or
I'm gonna put it in front of six, so I'm gonna shift everything down a little bit.
Yeah, you know, because it's kind of got it's unique in that way. I think you're right. God, it's close. Yeah, it's got on my second taste, it's got a little more heat to it than I remember than I got on the first taste, so I'm going in front as well. Okay, here's the one that's going to be tough. So I'm going to go back and retaste number seven and number four. I'm comparing those directly because that's an important spot.
Okay.
I think I'm going to keep number one in number one. Now, I don't have any left, though. That's my issue.
I have some left, and that's the thing. It's like now I need to taste it after, like, I've had everything else.
Right.
So
let me go number seven. Okay, you go. You want to go first?
You go because you already know, like, what you're
going to do. I'm going to go seven here. Okay. That's good. Let's go with number four. Four is the fourth one we taste. I'm keeping it in the same place. Okay. Seven and four are staying the same.
All right.
Damn, that's good, though.
Let me give five and three a quick little sip again. So five, which is my last place. Yeah, five I'll keep in last.
Yeah, I'm staying that way, too.
Three. Three is definitely better than five.
Ooh.
We'll keep that where it is.
Wow, you and I completely disagreed on three. That's interesting. Oh, no, three's in your back, too. My bad. I'm sorry. I misunderstood. Yeah.
Seven, that's the one that you just tried, and you have that in what place?
I'm keeping
now?
It in third. I think four is, for me, four is still a flavor I'd prefer.
Seven, I'm still going to keep in the back right now. That wasn't it.
So I'm going to go back to, I'm comparing seven and eight right now. Eight was the last one we tasted, and that's a good one.
Yeah, right now I'm just kind of tasting through them backwards to see if that's still my order. And so far it is. Let's see, so glass six.
Man, this is tough. I might have to switch eight and seven. They're really close. Those are good, man. Actually, I've enjoyed all of them.
All right, six is pretty good. For sure in front of seven for me. Now, eight was the one that I moved up ahead of six, so let's see if that's consistent. Here we go, eight.
While you're tasting that, I'm curious, have you ever done a blind tasting with eight different ones before? I know on your birthday, we had, there was a fair amount.
Did you go through 10 or something? I think it was just like six.
It was just six. It wasn't even that many.
I still have that paper. I kept it.
It's tough.
The most I've done was my Wild Turkey Blind that I broke into like a two-part video. Because that may have been seven or eight. Because it was 101, Russell's 10, Russell's Single Barrel, Rare Breed, Long Branch, Russell's 13, 101 12-year.
I just went for the whole thing.
And Kentucky Spirit. So that was eight as well, unless I'm missing one. But yeah.
I have to do it one more time. So I'm still comparing seven and eight.
I might put 6 back in front of 8.
Yeah, I'm switching. I'm putting 8 in front of 7. Decided.
I'll keep 8 where it's at. Okay.
Okay, I think I've got my final. But no worries, no rush. Yeah.
Here we go, back to... So I'm in my top 3 now, so number 2.
There's a lot of contemplation going on. Top 3, it's important, man, right? It's a
3 has like really strong qualities, but then other qualities I don't quite like.
Oh, your third place, you mean? Yeah, I got you. Which is your third place right now?
2.
2, okay.
But I'm going to swap that with glass 8.
Oh, okay.
Man, part of me wants to put 6 in front of it too, but I think I'll keep them where they're at. So now I'm in my top 2, glass 4 and 1.
So funny, you and I both. Similar palette on that. Yeah, right. You and I both have the top 2 the same.
And I'm actually going to go to 1 now.
Okay.
God, that smells just coming back right? to shit. Like,
it didn't take me too long to decide, I'll be honest with you. It's kind of wild to start.
That's still number 1. Number 2. Still number 2. All right. Okay. I have my ranking. You tell us yours.
Okay, first. We'll go. So in 8th place, number 5. In 7th place, number 3. 6th place, number 2. 5th place, I put number 6. In 4th place, number 7. 3rd place, I moved up. Number 8 is going into 3rd place. And then 4 in 2nd, and 1 is my winner.
All right, so mine is 8th place is number 5.
Okay.
7th place is 3. 3rd mm-hmm. place is 7. Mm-hmm. 4th place, sorry, no, 5th place is 6.
Same as you.
4th place is 2. 3rd is 8th as well.
Okay.
Then 4 and 2nd,
okay,
1 and 1.
So we did have some mixes, but some of the big ones, we were still in the same place. How funny.
All right, let me see. Sorry, I'm going to write in my notes real quick. Glass 5, glass 3.
I can without a doubt say that all of them are tasty, man. This is every time you've busted out the Nelson Bros, we have not been disappointed. I'll just throw that out there.
Yeah, this was definitely a fun one to do.
Like I said, I know... I'm not as knowledgeable as you and others on the whiskeys and rye and bourbons and stuff. But like the fact that so many of these, the same brand can taste so different. It's pretty cool. They get such a variety.
Yeah.
Of flavors.
There's a few here that I feel like I could definitely guess them.
Yeah. Same here.
Or like one 4 of them. But yeah, let's find out. Let me grab the list. I got it over here.
Yeah, no problem.
All right, so I will say this. I'm going to do my guesses real quick.
Yeah, go for it, please.
I know that some people frown on this, but I'm going to do it anyway. I think that 5 is the regular sour mash. I think 3 is the classic. I think 6 is reserve bourbon. I think 2 is sour mash cask strength. And I think 4 is honey.
Oh, wow. Really?
Man. Yeah.
Okay, I was thinking 6 is classic.
Okay. I think that's what I said. Yeah, I think I said 6 classic. Yeah.
I thought you said 3 classic, my bad.
No, 3 is, I think, no, classic, yeah. 6 reserve, 3 6 classic. 6
reserve.
I think.
What's the strength on the, really? Mm-hmm. You think that was 107? Okay. I'd be interested to see. I thought 6 was the one that was like the good balance of all of them. That's why I thought that might be classic.
Okay.
I out of the sight of that, I have no guesses at this point. The ones that are a little bit more sweeter, I thought maybe one of them might be the sherry.
Right.
And then the honey, I thought I'd be able to pick out the honey. You think that?
I think that's for sure 2nd place.
That's 4. Gotcha. I can't remember, man. My brain is so fried at this point.
But
so.
I made it a point to not say it out loud because I was like, this is has to be
the honey. Okay, let's take a look. This is fine. Right.
So here we go. So we both have 5 in glass 5 and last, right?
Yes.
Okay, sorry. All right, yeah, so I was correct. That is their regular sour mash.
That is a rare.
It's like a $30 bottle. This is their wheated mash bill coming in at 91 proof.
Even though we put it at last place for $30, not bad at all, man.
Yeah. It was almost flip-flopping for me a little bit.
Okay.
All right. Glass number 3 is at both our 7th place. Yeah, classic. So glass that number is 3, classic.
Okay, interesting.
This one is about like $40-ish dollars, and this is coming in at 93.3 proof. They're kind of typical standard bourbon. High rye mash bill. My 6th place is glass 7.
Okay.
Is that also yours?
No, that's my 4th.
Okay, so.
What do you got there?
Glass 7, for me, 6th place is the rye.
Oh.
And that's your 4th. I remember when you put it up, too. I had that up a little bit.
Dude, no joke. I've been drinking Sagamore recently. Okay, okay. So, like, for the last couple, all I've been drinking is rye. So, this is no wonder. Okay.
Okay.
I've been in a rye kind of mood.
And that's the one I think you said had the banana note. Maybe,
yeah, just like it, that hits a banana. Interesting. Okay.
I remember I had that flip-flopping a little bit. Okay. So then glass number. Oh, I should have went in like. I'm going in my placement order. Yeah, my bad. So glass number. Oh, shit. Glass number six.
Okay.
Cognac finish.
No way. Really? No. That one. Yes. That doesn't surprise me, actually. Because it lacked some of the heat that I thought. Yeah, I had it was a little bit sweeter to me.
Yeah. Man, I think that was the reserve. Wow.
Oh, interesting.
And that one, I don't know the proof. I think it's under 100. It's on the other side of the table.
It's 96.7. There you go. Ooh.
And then glass number two, which is my fourth place.
That's my sixth place.
Okay. That is cask strength sour mash. So the cask strength version of it.
Wow,
so, and I remember for both of us, we're like, man, yeah, that's pretty strong right off
the
bat.
Yeah.
And that's part of why three didn't stand a chance.
Right.
So this was a distillery only release that they came out with once they finished the renovations on their distillery.
Oh, nice.
And this is 121.4.
Yeah, definitely proof. It's probably the strongest.
Look at that color too.
Yeah,
nice,
man.
Nice and dark.
Good label.
All right. So glass number eight, that was my third place.
That was
and yours
my third
as well,
place,
right?
Yeah.
That was the reserve. Okay.
That's the reserve. Okay, there we go.
107.8 proof. This is about $55. This one you can find like pretty much everywhere.
How much did you say?
Around like $55.
Oh, dude, that's a good price.
Yeah.
You think standard. All the work it had to do, like it had to beat out, it was the last one we tasted and it beat out, I moved it up quite a bit. So
I was almost thinking that was going to be the cognac, which is interesting.
Okay.
Yeah. Yeah. Not, I literally it. That. Cause I remember saying I thought six was reserve, but. That's cool. And then, so second place was four for
both
of us.
And I,
yep, that was the honey cask.
Okay, there you go.
And then, right. So that makes number one, the sherry.
The sherry, man. What a winner.
Yeah. So again, going by the glasses, glass one was sherry. And what was the proof on this one? This has to be over 100.
I would imagine.
Oh, it's 100. Okay, wow, right off the bat.
Can you even get that at this point?
Nope. So
Good
news, though. I was told this just a couple days ago from Becky, the brand ambassador that was on the show. She messaged me saying that all their finishes are coming to California.
Oh, cool.
So
cool.
I don't know when exactly, but it should be soon. Who knows if it's going to be all of them or just specific ones, but they are eventually going to be sold in California pretty soon, which is awesome. So now, you know, those of you that listen to the show and you're like, well, that sucks. I can't get a hold of any of this. Just hang tight because they are coming. So that's pretty awesome.
As much as number one did win out for the sherry finish went out for me. The top three were just dynamite, man. I liked them all, but I mean, the top three were just like, damn.
Yeah, I'm stoked the note of the reserve like stuck up to those other ones.
Absolutely, man.
And the cask strength was better than I remember, I think, like compared with everything. I think the classic just when you have all these other kind of more heavier hitters. It's like, yeah, it's a hard one to keep up. Same with their regular weeded one.
And you think about classic, like if it's your flagship, like it's got to appeal to a wide audience. Mm-hmm. So, you know, you and I really enjoy this stuff. So,
I mean, I do remember it having that really, even though it was light, it had that nice like caramel.
Oh, it's great.
Back
end.
Like I think I said, like, all right, that's your quintessential kind of.
Wait, was it number right six? There. What number was classic?
Classic was three. So I'll go over the
classic
again.
Was three.
So glass one was sherry. Yeah, glass two was cask strength sour mash. Glass three was classic. Glass four was honey. Glass five was sour mash. Glass six was cognac. Glass seven was rye. And glass eight was reserved. I think the honey is like 107 proof too or something. 107.2, which is nice. I think that's why it lit up the tongue in such a great way.
Yeah, no kidding, like, man. That was really tasty.
All right, I'm just going to mix all my glasses together that are left.
Oh, you're going for it. Okay, that's not a bad idea.
Let's just do a little infinity pour.
I'm going to join them. That's a good idea.
I feel like there's not enough like sips left to like really savor any of them, so I might as well just throw them together. Not bad. I also don't feel like super buzzed or anything,
I think we
did this appropriately.
But I am glad I had a huge-ass cheeseburger before we did this. So.
Same. All right. Cool, everybody. Yeah, that was a lot of fun. I think this is one of the funnest blinds I've done.
Yeah, that was great.
So far, it was just like cool to do it with someone too.
What make a man brave a blizzard, kill in cold blood? I'm sure I don't know. You'd be surprised what a man would do.
You starting to see pictures, ain't you? Got room for one more?
I ain't too anxious to be handing out rides.
Real trusting fella, huh?
Not so much. Ain't no way I'm spending a couple of nights under a roof with somebody I don't know who they are. So who are you?
Okay, everybody, hear this. I'm taking this woman to hang.
Reward's
$10,000. That money's mine, boys.
Oh, that's interesting.
Yeah.
Hold on!
You think I'll make cahoots with that fella or her?
That's my problem, boy. I don't know.
One of them fellas will kill everybody in here.
Now we're talking!
Let's slow it down. Let's slow it way down.
When you get to hell, tell them Daisy sent you.
Come on, you gonna die now?
No one said this job's supposed to be easy.
Nobody said it's supposed to be that hard, neither.
The Hateful Eight, man. Quentin Tarantino's eighth film from 2015.
And if you didn't know it was eighth film, it says right there on the titles. It's yeah. It's his eighth film.
Yeah, he loves doing that sometimes. Yeah,
it cracks me up.
Such a great movie. For me, it gets better every time.
What's your history with it?
So I remember when it was first like in the talks of this movie happening, his new script, what it was called. I think there was a little teaser too.
Mm-hmm.
And I remember the controversy about how one of the actors or their agents or whatever leaked the script,
but
it was like draft one or something.
Right,
so there's this whole debacle where he was mad about it and blah, blah, blah. And like, he was almost not going to make the movie anymore or whatever. So I remember all that stuff. I remember that came to pass and then, you know, other version of the script. And then they even did when he did most of the casting. They did the live table reads that people could go to see.
Yeah.
So the live table reads with a bunch of the actors. I think most of them stayed on for the movie. And then eventually we got the movie. And one of the big kind of, especially with us being camera people and in the cinematography, one of the big notes about what was going to happen with this movie was the fact that they were shooting in 70mm.
70mm.
So all 70mm film. This whole idea of like, oh, and it all takes place in one location. So it's almost kind of back to the roots of like, very Reservoir Dog style and I thought that was all very interesting, very intriguing. I made it a point to go see this movie in 70mm at the Cinerama Dome in Hollywood, like opening night. And I was thinking back, I was like, was that the last movie I saw there? I don't remember. I hope not. I don't think it was, but it may have been. But
is there anything in there nowadays?
No, it's just like shut down. It's boarded up.
It boarded up. Okay.
Supposedly, I came across an article that they're going to reopen in 2025, maybe.
Oh, okay.
Who knows? Yeah. But, and I remember loving it. I was like, great, 70mm film print, like the roadshow. Because the thing was, there's the roadshow version, which is the full maxed out with the overture in the beginning, 15-minute intermission, then the rest of the movie. Then you could see like the digital, like the DCP version that didn't have that.
Right.
New Beverly was playing 35mm print. So I saw this movie in all three of those formats.
Oh, like wow.
First in 70mm, then I went to see the DCP.
Yeah.
And then I went to see it at New Beverly on 35.
So those two didn't have the intermission then?
Or do they? I think the roadshow was at New Beverly, even though it was the 35 print.
It was still there.
I think it was that extended version.
Got it.
The DCP I saw elsewhere, I think, was the shortened one, if I remember correctly.
Got it. Okay, interesting.
And I remember walking away from it, like every Quentin Tarantino movie is an event movie, for me. It's you're going to go see it. You're going to enjoy it. It's going to be great. And I remember walking away from it like, man, that was really good. Like probably not my favorite, but that was good. You know, kind of weird at points, whatever. But every time I'd go back to see it, and still to this day, every time I go back to see it, it just gets better and better and better and better and better, which is great. And I felt the same way about Once Upon a Time in Hollywood, too. I remember like walking away the first time. I was like, not my favorite, like really good. And I feel like I could pick up on the little nuances. That's cool. Like, not my favorite, though. And that's another one that gets better and better and better. I know you said it kind of has evolved for you over time. So what's your history with this one?
So I saw it at Arclight, but it was still the roadshow print. And it was actually on 70mm. They were shooting the 70mm print. And my dad really wanted to go see it. My dad is basically the guy who introduced me to Quentin. I didn't get a chance to see Pulp Fiction in theaters, which is a real bummer. But my dad had seen Reservoir Dogs on video. So he's like, okay, I got to see this next one. And so when did Pulp Fiction, 94, 90? So we probably didn't watch till 95, 96. I'm still only like 12 or 13 years, 14 years old at that time. Mm-hmm. But my dad was like, we got to watch this film together, you know? So it's you've mentioned it before too, about like sharing it with somebody you know, you're that close to. And so my dad and I went to go see it, and there's not too many experiences I've had with film like I had with this one, where you got the great thing back in the day, the Arclight was one of the few theaters that was black box. So there were no lights on, you know? Mm. So you're in complete darkness. You've got this wonderful soundtrack. You've got the 70 mil. And my first time seeing it, and digital was starting to become everywhere, right? But the clarity to a 70 millimeter print was just, everything looked, it literally felt, for 3 hours, it felt like I was in that cabin with these characters.
Yeah.
And it's the thing I remember the most with my dad, feeling like I was with my dad sharing this space with the people I'm watching on the screen. And so you see the smile on my face ear to ear because I have such good memories. My dad was down for it. It's the first film I had seen with an intermission. And since then, I don't think I've seen any other actual theater experiences with intermissions. I've been to IMAXs and stuff, but IMAX is, you know, it's taller. Mm-hmm. It's not necessarily right, this wide thing, yeah. You know? So it's like, it was something like I had never, like I could literally have to move my eyes and my head left to right to see because I wanted to see everything that was in the frame.
Yeah.
Like, what's he hiding over there? And that's one of the things that I'd never had such an experience where I was so, felt like I was there. And at the same time, I wanted to see everything, you know, all the time. There was so much in every single frame that it's just like, it was magical. It sounds so stupid to say, literally a magical experience, man.
Yeah.
You know?
No, it really is. It truly is. Especially when you go to a place like, you know, Arclight Hollywood, like the Cinerama Dome, right, where right. It was essentially made for that.
Literally.
Venue, right. You know? And just, it's amazing to think too, like being a camera nerd, that they dug deep into Panavision and found like these ultra old lenses that like shot Ben-Hur and shit like that. And like that hadn't been used in decades. Like literally he said that they're the same lenses that shot, It's a Mad, 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 Mad World. Yeah. And literally not like the same brand, like the same exact lenses that were on that movie,
jeez,
which is crazy. And like, that's again, so Ben-Hur and shit like that. Yeah. I thought it was really cool too, that just like a year later, then Rogue One use these same lenses from this movie, but on the Alexa 65. That one, I remember that. Yeah. Like I thought that was pretty dope.
I think this is the interesting part for me. And I think I told you this already, but like, I haven't watched the film since then. I purchased it when it came out. As soon as it came out, I have the film. And I was trying to ask myself, like, why haven't I watched this since? And I got to tell you, the experience, while it's still, there's nothing that takes away from it, it's still a wonderful film. The experience is different when you're watching it on, and I got a pretty big TV, but I can't replicate what that experience was like. You know, there's just nothing that's going to replicate that unless I owned a theater like Quentin does.
Yeah.
Right? Just go to Quentin's theater. So like, I don't want to, it was such a different experience rewatching it this time than it was that. And I didn't have that same kind of magic, but it got me more, I spent a lot more time paying attention to the characters and what their, you know, their actions and what they're saying and all that kind of stuff. Not saying I didn't experience that the first time, but it definitely was a different experience this time. One of the things that I still think that Quentin does so freaking well is that none of his movies, in my opinion, ever feel long. Mm. And this movie is mostly just talking with some moments of really extreme violence. Like, that's basically what the film is. Like, there's the first prologue-ish thing, you know, there's about 20 or 30 minutes where they're, you know, they're riding up into the snow up to the cabin. But besides that, there's it's literally talking and it never feels long.
Yeah, it never feels long. It's so entertaining the way through. Like, you see that every moment is necessary. Mm-hmm. No filler. Nothing is a waste of time. Nothing is there just for the sake of being there. Like, everything drives it forward. And I was thinking about the aspect too, because, you know, there's a lot like, oh, Oppenheimer's really long. Like, Killers of the Flower Moon was really long. Irishman, like, Scorsese just keeps churning out these long movies. Like, someone was talking to me about how Killers of the Flower Moon should have been cut down like a full hour and this and that. And I'm like thinking about all these movies and then this one too, and how, especially once you get like post intermission, like after General Smithers gets killed, like it goes. I remember even in the theater, it's like, oh, it's like pedal to the metal to all the way to the end of this movie now. And it still kind of feels that way. And yeah, man, like super entertaining 3 hours, whatever.
I would agree. And you're always wondering why I was this time, the second time through, I noticed I don't remember thinking this when I saw it in the theaters, but one of the things this movie does great is like, none of the characters can be trusted. Mm-hmm. at every twist and turn, all of the characters are lying at some point in this movie.
Yeah.
And what an interesting approach to a film where you literally can't trust anybody who's on screen. It inherently creates this, like, this risk and this suspense, you know, that, you know, you try to create with the ticking time bomb under the table, but no, all you got to do is make all your characters liars. And now you don't know what the fuck is going to happen at any point in the film. Like, such a,
except one of them, which I think is great. Well, as far as we know, right. Yeah. But like, I feel like the one, well, and I guess we can include General Smithers in this too, but like Chris Mannix.
Well, I mean, do we think he's still a share?
I think so.
Okay. I mean, it doesn't explicitly say.
We don't necessarily ever know, but I feel like he's so who he is just all the way through it. He's like, just, this is me.
Yeah. But what Quentin does so great is that all the other characters don't believe him.
Yeah.
So like, I'm on the same path. Right. I don't fucking know.
Yeah.
That's a good point.
And that's, of course, in retrospect too. Like, as the movie's going, like, everyone's for sure suspicious. Yeah. And, you know, we obviously got to point out, like, we talked about The Thing recently.
Yeah.
We obviously have to point out how that was a really big influence on this movie.
You can totally tell.
And that idea of, like, the one location, winter, in, like, just all about the paranoia. Dude. Like, one of these people is not who he says he is. You know, Kurt Russell, obviously. The score by Ennio Morricone.
The score's great.
Which is awesome because some of them, like, there's music that was written specifically for this, obviously, but there's a lot of music in this movie that was originally from The Thing, but John Carpenter didn't use it. So it's literally like there's big chunks of music in this movie were written years ago.
Oh, wow.
Specifically for The Thing, and just, you know, he discarded it.
Yeah, I didn't either.
So they used it here and it kind of.
Wow, wild. Mm-hmm. I had no idea.
Yeah. Which is awesome. And I always thought it was really interesting. One, because this was the first movie that Quentin had an original score for. He had never done it. He used a lot of Ennio Morricone music from other movies and Luis Bacalov and all kinds of Riz Ortolani, all kinds of people. But this is the first time it was written for this film.
Oh, I didn't realize that.
Which is like pretty cool and interesting. And I love that it has like the Western vibe, but like also horror movie at the same time. Like I remember walking into the theater and the overture before the movie starts.
Yes.
Like, really sets the tone of, are we about to watch, like, a creepy...
Yeah.
Like, it just feels very creepy and disturbing. You know, when that music kicks in, it, like, starts with those landscape shots. And then that shot of, like, the Jesus, like, the cross with the snow on it, the wagon going by. And that, like, super low, like, I'm guessing that's, like, a contrabass bassoon or something.
Something
and,
like that,
the music, right? And that music gets going and just builds and builds and builds and builds. It's so great.
So that's one of the things that struck me right away. When I saw it in theaters, once again, I felt cold as I was watching. Like, I felt like I needed to cover up. That some of that gets a little lost when I was watching it at home nowadays. And like, I don't mean to keep harping on just how it's not the same experience, but it's not the same experience, you know? It's like one of those things like, oh damn, this just does not translate the same way that it did when I saw it in the theater. So at the same time, completely agree. Like, what a way to set a tone for a film. And it honors a lot of other frontier type films at the same time, while still is creating setting his stage for the story he wants to tell. And it does it really well. It's fun to see some. I love stuff like this because I live in the suburbs of Southern California. I never see, you know, snow cover. I never experienced a blizzard or any shit like that. So for me, it puts me in a place I've never been before. So,
yeah.
Super cool.
One thing I forgot to do was deliver the synopsis. I'll do it real quick. Essentially, what we have is this bounty hunter, John Ruth the Hangman, is transporting this prisoner to Red Rock to be hung so he can get paid $10,000 bounty for this lady, Daisy Domergue.
Daisy Domergue.
And he's very paranoid that other people are going to try to, you know, come in and steal her and take the bounty or whatever.
So much so, he has her handcuffed.
Yeah, like she's handcuffed to him. And there's a blizzard on the way. And they pick up some, you know, stragglers that are all stuck in this blizzard. And so now all... nine really of these people are all stuck in this cabin together in the haberdashery until the until the blizzard passes so that they can move on to Red Rock and be on their way. But he is very paranoid because someone's lying and is going to try to take the shit from him. And so, you know, hate ensues. And I mean, sorry, what were you going to say?
No, please.
No, I was just going to, so that's, you know, sets the stage. The setup. And Every bit of dialogue and writing in this movie is so good and entertaining and funny and quotable and has like some interesting history to it. And I don't know, man. I think time and time again in all his films, he shows just an extraordinary talent for writing characters, man. And this is no different. You know, we start with them picking up Samuel Jackson's character in the snow. And I just love the back and forth with him and Kurt Russell mm-hmm. about like giving him a ride and all that.
The language is so many. It does so many things in his films. Mm-hmm. Like one, it is expository. It's at some point it's pushing a plot forward,
yeah.
But more importantly, it reveals so many different things about these characters and who doesn't trust who, who's lying, who can you trust? Where do these people come from? Interestingly enough, in this film, there are some flashbacks, but they're flashbacks to like the morning,
yeah,
the day
right.
before, right?
Right.
So you get to learn a lot about the characters through what they're saying and also how they're saying it, you know? And so I just think it does so much. On top of that, it keeps us entertained, which, you know, we've talked a lot about Christopher Nolan. One of the things he's, and I don't always agree with this, but one of the things he's, critics have mentioned about Nolan is that a lot of his writing is expository. It's specifically right, there to right. push the plot forward.
Yeah.
And while Quentin's dialogue at times does that as well, it also just enhances the world. Like the language is almost one of the things that creates this world, because for the most part, we're going to be in two locations. We're climbing up yeah. the mountain during the blizzard, and then we're at the cabin, you know? And so the language is one of the things that helps create this whole yeah. place, right?
And it does a good job of like, and because we're Chris Nolan, I feel it just very direct with the
totally.
Exposition of like, yeah. so like Inception is probably yeah. the best example right. of like explaining
yeah,
everything.
Certainly.
Here, it's like you get into like some history about the characters and you learn about them that way.
Yeah.
You know, like, oh, Major Marquess, right. you're this and the letter from Lincoln or whatever. But then that goes into like, oh, well, here's Chris Mannix's perspective on him. And like, oh, John Ruth, here's something you don't know about this guy. They ran him out of the cavalry with a yellow stripe down his back, you know, whatever. And setting up a lot of this stuff that like eventually pays off later. The Lincoln letter pays off in a nice way. The, you know, all the, yeah, they sent people were going head hunting for me. And the ones that you ain't never heard from again, they found me. You know what
I mean? Like that. And in addition to
it all like, comes back later.
The prejudices that these characters have, like that's, you get to know about like who they, why and who they don't trust, who they're racist against.
Yeah.
You know, all these things that I'm glad the film didn't shy away from that. I was reading an interview that Quentin did about, I guess one of the things he was accused of at the time, I don't even remember this, but like how blatantly racist some of these things
yeah.
in the film were. And he's like, he wanted to force you into uncomfortableness.
Yeah.
And I think this film does such a great job of like forcing you to face some of the awful things that have happened in this country from
yeah.
Right. And don't look away from, you're forced to stay with it. And here are the way people talk and the way they treated each other and stuff.
Yeah.
You know?
Even I was watching an interview where he talks about it in regards to Daisy too. He's
right?
like, he's like the first time Kurt Russell like cracks her in the face. He's
dude.
Like, it's meant to be a shock. Like,
yeah, it's meant dude, to it's like brutal, man.
To make you cringe and get you thinking like, and
it's not just
is
that
he really like the good guy here?
And
like,
he made her gush blood. It wasn't just like she got hit and she's okay, right? It's like,
yeah.
Oh man, there's repercussions.
Yeah, like he breaks her teeth out. Like
literally, in the movie. So brutal, man.
But yeah, and an interesting time to set this too, like post-Civil War, years after. And I love that Major Marquess. It's like still like Union uniform. The general is still like Confederate. And then Chris Mannix, like the rebel renegades in the middle. And I got to say, man, Chris Mannix is probably my favorite character in this whole movie.
Goggins, the racist.
Yeah. But besides,
but it's only political. That's just political talk. That's not a,
yeah, yeah. I don't, not my favorite character because he's a racist.
No,
but, you know, I mean, I love all the characters like Kurt Russell, Sam Jackson, but I think he did an amazing job with, and I wish I could find this interview again, but I feel like I had heard at one point Quentin talk about like writing that part and like, how do I write this like pretty awful character, very awful character. But when we hear his perspective of it, because there is that moment, right? When they're talking shit to him and he's explaining, my daddy's, you know, renegade army, blah, 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 this and that. And when they talk about, and Samuel Jackson is like, I burned it down, like burned the prison. And they
and
start laughing.
And they start
laughing. But for Chris, and it's like, yeah, we can all look and point, and they're the bad guys, race or whatever. But I love, and really good acting on his side, how he's kind of taken aback by the fact that they're laughing about it. And he's like, that was a rookie regiment. Like, you burned like 20 people alive, like kids, brother. And I love how he looks at like, like, we were your brothers and shit like that. And like, I don't feel like, for the racist aspect of it, obviously. Right. But I like that he can,
you understand where he's coming from. Yeah.
Like,
of it,
his kind of side, like side of that, like the human side of it. Right. But I just love that dialogue between like the major and him and the back and forth, like, oh, the prisoner you burn the prison camp and, you know, just so you can make a run for the trees. All that stuff is so good, man. Puts a gun at him. I'm just happy to be alive. I'm just going to sleep here and be grateful. That's so good.
So here's where you and I may disagree a little bit. Okay. And so this is, I haven't visited the film since I saw it in theaters. And I was wondering why? Because mostly, except for Once Upon a Time in Hollywood, all of Quentin's other films I've revisited at least more than once. And one of the things I noticed this time through is I struggled to, all of the characters have done bad things in their life, all the characters in this film. And I think that's why it was tough for me, or why I didn't want to revisit it, because all of these people are doing bad things. And I'm not sure there are reasons to redeem them, to say the least, like why I should perhaps, pardon them or accept them for who they are. Because in the end, all of the people in this room are murderers. And I think that's one of the things that I struggled with, like why I haven't revisited. I don't know if that's for sure or not. And there's all this racism and all this kind of stuff, like just really stuff that's tough to swallow. But when I started reading Quentin's interview, I'm like, you know what? We can't ignore this. This is part of our history. This is literally how a lot of these things went down. And so when I got past that, I did, like your point, I was trying to maybe be a little bit more understanding or empathetic of some of these people's motivations, like violence begets violence. You know, one thing happens, you want to be violent back and all those kinds of things. I think that's one of the reasons that I've struggled, or I haven't gone and revisited, because so many of the characters do bad things in this film and have done bad things.
And so much of it is based out of like survival too, right? Like just the time purely period, survival and trying to get by. And it's funny, like I think about Chris Mannix too, right? Like again, and we're talking about these bad things. Yeah. When I think about his character, and this is what I like, right? Like he has these certain beliefs.
Sure.
But to me, among that group, he's probably the least like violent and the least like in his mind probably didn't necessarily do anything wrong. You know what I mean?
It was war.
Whereas everybody else, and even Major Marquess, like even whether the story with the general's son and all that is because that's another one. It's like you almost don't even know to believe him. Like, is he just making this up to kill this man?
Yeah.
Or did this all really happen?
It's the brilliance of the film, though, is like that he set it up where you just can't trust that. So it makes you have to revisit it. Yeah. It's so brilliant.
Yeah.
I agree. And it's a really good point that it does make you, I guess for me, like the Mannix character, within the first or second sentence when he actually gets into the stagecoach, he's using the N-word. And I'm just like, I understand that's a product of the time period, but I'm like, this racist motherfucker, you know, that's all I'm thinking in my head. So I got to get past my own prejudice to find some empathy for the guy, right? So, you know, that's one of the things where I just like, Quentin is, that's what I think this film does brilliantly. He's constantly challenging us to follow these characters, and can you find empathy for them? Can you find some reason to actually care about them past what you see on the surface?
Well, and I love so much that in the end, the last two standing was like them, Major Marquess and Chris Mannix are like the last one standing. And like have to work together and they're going to die together.
The last
together.
Hour of the film, they got to work together, right?
And they're going to like literally just die together and all that stuff almost doesn't matter. And I posted this scene on the Instagram, dude. I got so tense. I'll never forget this feeling. But the moment when, and I'm skipping way ahead, but
it's okay.
When Sam Jackson's already shot, everything goes haywire. Sam Jackson's out of ammo. So now Chris is the only one with the gun. And there's that great music from The Thing. It's that music when they find the ship. And when Mannix like looks that he has the gun and then looks back at Sam Jackson and just like sits down and he's like, I want to hear her sell. And I was like, oh my God, he's going to kill.
Yeah, he's going to waste.
He's going to kill him. Like, why wouldn't he? We know he's this racist guy. We know he doesn't like the Major Warren. Because even the whole time, like with the Lincoln letter, he's trying to expose him for who he is.
Yes,
right?
Totally.
Like he's getting on his case and shit. But man, when he's like, no deal, I like cheer. I'm like, yes, yes, come together. I love that so much. Seeing as how she ain't got nothing to sell, I want to hear her sales pitch.
One of the things that Quentin does so well is the sudden bouts of violence in almost all of his films. Yeah. Like just all of a sudden this extreme violence comes. And I think it's actually really effective in almost all of his films.
Yeah.
It's interesting. By the time this was his eighth film, and I had seen all previous sevens. So it's almost funny thinking that I did go into the theater with a little bit of a notion. I know he's going to survive this. Like because I've seen Reservoir Dogs, you know, because I've seen some of his other Jackie Brown to except for, you know, one person, a lot of people don't make it out of that film. So like I go into that notion and yet I'm still on the edge of my seat knowing and still even when the, you know, the suspense of who's going to drink the coffee first, like if you don't mind getting into it a little bit, I almost forgot that there was this moment where this voiceover happens. And I remember thinking in the theater, what the fuck is going on? We're going to be a voiceover an hour and a half into the film or whatever.
I remember that's one of those moments where in the theater, you kind of feel everyone thinking that.
I was literally
like
looking around.
Like the air like shifts or everyone's like, okay, I guess this is what we're doing.
Only
now.
In
like,
his world.
Now we have a narrator. And just for that moment, too. Like, just never comes back. Yeah.
But what an interesting way to do it, that you're setting up a suspense. In a movie that, you know, he's already found ways to set up our suspense just by not trusting anybody. But the fact that now we're looking for is the coffee. We can't think about anything else about who's going to drink the fucking coffee first, right?
And by, like, telling the audience that, too. Because the other way to go about it would have been to, like, not say shit about
not
that.
Say anything
and then
about
they
it.
Just suddenly throw up blood. But now, you're looking for that. And one other aspect I appreciate about the 70 millimeter, which I didn't quite get it in the beginning when they announced and this is what it was going to be. I remember being very surprised and like, why would he choose like basically a single location movie to use that format? Like why you would think this would be in like Django Unchained, for example, like that should have been the 70 mil movie, but
kind of wish that, but anyway,
but the way he employs it here and it makes so much sense. Like, we do get the beautiful landscape shots,
but that's
having that
short
large,
part of the time.
Yeah, but having that large format, like in the building, talking about like the close-ups and what you can see, because so much of the movie is the background.
Dude, the depth.
Right? And whenever you look and whenever I watch this movie, I always make it a point to like look at the people in the background. It's like there's a close-up on someone, they're having dialogue, but I always watch everybody else.
Dude,
and
for
it's
real,
so,
man.
It's so masterfully blocked to make sense and you try to track like where is everybody at certain points. What is everybody doing?
The depth in this film is, you know, one of my favorite examples of depth in frames and stuff like that is actually from the original Star Wars trilogies. Mm. I think it's actually one of the reasons why those films felt like so different sci-fi wise, because you could see the burns and the scars and the scratches and the dirtiness of space at the time. The depth, how far back some of these, and we're in one location, but you could just see there's so much filling the frame. It makes you want to pay attention to everything. Yeah. And that's when you know a film is working, by the way, when you are, you know, looking around, I want to see, am I missing something? You want to stay engrossed and engaged in the whole thing. It's pretty amazing, man.
And you can always pick out little details. Like it's one of those, where you can always go back and watch it later and like see little details, even in their performances,
right?
The way they react to certain things. Like when Tim Roth goes up to Chris Maddox at some point and early in the beginning, when he first comes in after they put the lines out and he's like, what did he mean by his, you know, friend in the stable? And he's just like, well, he's got another friend in the stable, another bounty hunter friend. And he's like, interesting. Because when you first see that, you don't really think anything about it. But when you know he's one of the bad guys and they weren't expecting all these people, you know, that raises a red flag for them.
I totally agree with that. And I can't believe we've gone this far without even mentioning the goddamn door. That is just the footage. I also love that you get to see the door from like multiple angles.
Yeah.
Like this, the ridiculousness of everyone's yelling.
You gotta nail it shut.
Nail it shut.
Nail it shut. Like they keep repeating it. That shit's so funny.
There's a cool, it's not turning point, but where the film, you start to learn a little bit more about, there was an actual plot happening where Samuel Jackson's character gets shot from the floor, you know, and right into the crotch. And all of a sudden there's Now you're confirming some of the things that maybe you've already had thoughts on your mind. And I got to be honest, I didn't realize Channing Tatum was in this film. I didn't know who he was in 2015.
I still forget sometimes. Dude. So I forget he was in this.
Yeah, I totally forget. But a good use of casting, like having other additional characters. And I don't remember the flashback scenes when I saw it in the theaters, but it really does give you some really important information to the characters that are still alive in the present day, knowing that what their gang was consisted of and how they took over the haberdashery and all those kind of things. I thought it was a good time to do it. And some things like that could slow your film down or could get in the way of other things happening. But this one seems so like on the nose and on point, and it doesn't spend a ton of time with it to begin with. So I was like, oh man, this flashback works really well for a film like this.
It does. And even, you know, how and why they kept Bruce Dern there, whole attitude and the like how he reacts to.
Why didn't he get bumped off?
You know, Kurt Russell when he comes in and just not taking it. I love the general.
Sweet Dave. I was like, when Sweet Dave gets bumped off and stuff, I couldn't remember.
Poor guy.
The one line he has, he sounds like a sweet guy.
Yeah.
I just thought that was pretty funny watching it this time.
Sweet Dave.
Sweet Dave. Poor guy.
It's funny too, like how quickly Sam Jackson puts the pieces together. The moment he meets Bob in the stable,
He knows
it is immediately, you know, suspicious and all, because clearly of everyone there, he spent the most time at that haberdashery and knows the people the best. I love the what was it in the stable? He's like, "We're in the middle of a blizzard, and I ask to help you in the with stable work, and you say no," and he's just like, okay, you can help me, like right off the bat, right? And when he tries to catch him with the cigarette thing too, her pipe, and he's like, she rolls her own. I think you already know this. And later on, just in passing, when Channing Tatum is talking to Minnie and they're sharing the cigarette, and you see him just walk by in the background and look, and that's it. Just that moment. Mm-hmm. Yeah, just that moment to know, happen to look at the right place at the right time to save him for a while. Man.
Senor Bob. I almost forgot.
Oh, he's so good. Demian Bashir. So yeah, I'm just kind of sad that he gets picked off so early.
Not as quick as Kurt Russell and OB. The guy, I don't remember the
actor's name. Poor OB. That's Michael Parks.
Michael Parks, that's right.
Or his son.
Oh, that's his kid?
Yeah.
Oh, I didn't know that. Okay.
I forgot his first name.
That's not Parks, but.
Yeah. But he was also in Django Unchained Kill Bill and all that.
I'm trying to think. There's just so many subtle thing. Oh, here's one. Okay, this is what I want to talk. There are a lot of subtleties that, and this is probably what you're getting when you're watching it over and over again. This makes you want to watch it again, by the way. The costumes, I didn't notice when I was seeing this in theaters, some of those, like Samuel Jackson's wearing a part of his uniform, or you can tell, and so is the general.
Yeah.
I didn't notice those things at first, but they tell you a little bit about the character, and maybe that's the one thing you possibly can believe, is that these people, you know, served for the North and served for the South, you know, and everything like that. I appreciated like the really smart costume choices, and even the set. I mean, the set's just beautiful, but like when they're starting to undo the layers on the chairs where you saw what's his name?
Where Sweet Dave died,
you know, just little things like that. Just so many little subtleties around the whole place. It's funny because we're drinking a fair amount. You know, we got whiskey and bourbon out here and everything like that. And there's not a lot of drinking in this film. It was mostly centered around the coffee. There's the bar in the back and everything. But just little things like that I just thought were super interesting. Little moments that really fill out the world and put you in the space, you know?
Yeah, so many. It just a really interesting dynamic to get those types of characters in the room together too. You know, like we already have like Kurt Russell and Sam Jackson and Goggins, like in the wagon with the fugitive. There's that whole dynamic.
Yeah.
But then even walking into the place and then the hangman and talking about the legalities and the dispassion of frontier justice versus real justice, and having the like Confederate general in the mix with them. And of course, Mannix is like all into that. And I like how he's all excited, like, oh, you have a good eye, son. You know who I am. And when Sam Jackson tried to talk to him, and Mannix is being like the mouthpiece between them.
Oh, yeah.
Because Bruce Dern like refuses to even speak to this dude. I love that, though, and how eventually it like builds up to them. Like, it's almost kind of sad because it is kind of warm, right?
Oh, right.
When he gives him the soup and him the and stew. Sam Jack, the stew. Yeah. are sitting together and like having this talk.
Yeah, yeah.
Finally, like after tensions have cooled down. But then obviously it blows up into like a murder.
Well, see, that's the thing, man. And that's the thing that it makes, I think this is another reason why I struggled to revisit it, because I'm like, Sam Jackson is goading him. He wants to kill him.
Yeah.
And he's forcing him into this situation to do this thing, which is really fucked up, man. So it's like, yeah. That's what I think when I was like, God damn, can any of these characters have any redeeming qualities? Not so much, no. But you know, but I mean, that's the story that he wanted to tell. So I get that. And I respect that these people are very true to their characters for all the flaws that come with that, right?
It's an interesting moment too that I'm still not sure about. And I imagine this is all by design because, you know, I mentioned earlier, like, I wonder, like, is that all true or was he making that up just to kill him?
Just to kill him, yeah.
Because even Chris is like, don't listen to him. Like, he just overheard what you said earlier, so he's saying that. But then it also tracks with what they were talking about with the bounty on his head earlier in the wagon. And it's like, I guess I'm wondering what the, because even before this, Sam Jackson is like, as soon as he walks, because we already know he had that talk with Bob when they're in the stable. But as soon as he walks in and he's like looking at everybody.
Yeah.
And kind of like gauging everything, like he's
sizing up.
He's situation. Already, putting the pieces together. So I think about it strategically, right? Did he want to kill Smithers just because he wanted to, because of that battle and what he did with shooting down a bunch of POWs, or was it to just take him off the board altogether, like for the reason of like, we just got to get one person out of here to narrow it down? It's very that really part's very interesting.
Yeah,
to me.
Right. I mean, but he's the, like the oldest guy in the room. So is he a person you have to worry about? I don't even know, man. So, you know, but to your point, it seemed a lot of it. He does seem like the most strategic thinker, maybe next to Kurt Russell's character.
Yeah.
But I mean, definitely trying to think two plays ahead. Yeah. So,
and you never know. Yeah. Cause at this point we sure as hell don't know who's involved. Even in the beginning when like Chris Mannix could have easily been involved. Like, I love when they're in the wagon, they see him in the distance coming. Kurt, there's one of my favorite lines when he looks at Sam Jackson, he's like, awful lot of people wandering around in the blizzard, don't you? Like, don't you think? And he's like, seeing as how I'm half of those people,
I literally laughed out loud when I was watching this time around.
A little convenient. But I love how, you know, despite their color and this and that, because he has him, Sam Jackson, handcuffed,
yeah,
right?
Yeah, handcuffs.
But then Mannix refuses to do that. And I like when he's, all right, you help me protect mine. The fact that he undoes it, he's like, I'm going to trust you well before I trust Confederate renegade, you know, rebel riders, whatever they are.
And that's actually a kind of a theme. It's funny you mention that, because that's a kind of a theme throughout the film where characters decide, I don't know if they trust, or at least to make an alliance with other characters. Right.
Yeah.
And I love that.
Good point. Yeah.
Through alliance. Really like entertaining dialogue, it reveals why these characters are choosing to form an alliance with so-and-so and with so-and-so and with so-and-so. And it, especially watching it again, it all makes sense. Like you totally understand the motivations and why these people decide to join together and who's part of the gang and all that kind of stuff. So very, very, just really interesting the way that all those pieces connect and it all makes sense. Like that's not easy to do.
Did a Lincoln letter moment's really good too. Like I love how Kurt Russell does such a good performance here.
Yeah, he's great.
How he looks like so genuinely hurt by the fact that he was lied to.
Yeah.
And because Chris is like kind of ridiculing it. Like I just love the way John Root tells it, you know, he was practically pen pals and a pen pal is practically a friend. I just love the way he's grilling. I'm like,
John Root says you got a Lincoln letter.
I told you, jackass, go hee haw someplace else.
That's right, John. You did say that, did you?
Yeah, I did.
So, you got a letter from Abraham Lincoln?
Yes.
The Abraham Lincoln?
Yes.
Abraham Lincoln, the President of the United States?
Yes.
Of America?
Yes.
Wrote you a letter personally?
Yes.
Personally as in Dear Major Warren?
No, personally, as in Dear Marquess.
Dear Marquess, Abraham Lincoln, the President of the United States of America.
Yes.
May I see it?
No, you may not.
But the way John tells it, you weren't just some random soldier picked from a pile of letters. The way John tells it, y'all had a correspondence.
Yes.
The way John tells it, Y'all was practically pen pals.
Yes.
And a pen pal's practically a friend.
I guess that's one of those moments too when Sam Jackson tells him, like, you have no idea what it's like trying to survive black man in America. And he's, I'll tell you why I do this, because it got me on that wagon.
It got in that wagon, man.
Yeah.
Well,
I love that.
And I love the way the whole thing is gets tied into the very end of the film, where, like, at the very
end. Read it at the end.
Oh, dude. That was like a dude, I'm like, wow, what a great
It almost
way.
Makes you emotional.
It almost does, because Mannix is reading it knowing it's bullshit.
Yeah.
And that doesn't matter.
Yeah.
Like, how interesting is that choice there at that point? I didn't remember that resonating with me as much as it did this time around. Maybe because I'm, you know, 8 years older now. So, but I'm like, damn, man, that's beautiful.
With like the solo trumpet and then the camera just slowly pulling out and up. And he says the same thing Kurt Russell said earlier, the old Mary Todd's calling. It's a nice touch. it's so great, man.
One of the things I enjoyed more this time around, which was surprising to me, was Jennifer Jason Leigh's performance. Like, what a tough character to have to like portray, because she's putting her, like a lot of the characters she plays in many of her performances, she has to put her, you have to go to some extremes, you know, to pull off the character properly. And she can be so disliked at certain times, but then you have to feel something for her because people are beating the shit out of her left and right. You know, but then you can see that she's thinking things over at times, just a lot more dimensions than I remember first watching the film. And I was probably just so enamored with everything that else was going on. I'm like, oh, dude, there are tons of things she's emoting on screen that, like, you realize the second time around all the pieces that are being placed in her brain. And a lot of times she doesn't get to tell her story because, you know, she's the one getting the shit kicked out of her.
I like how she'll add a little bit of humor to certain moments too. And how, even though she doesn't say much, like, she knows a lot of information on people, like, even in the wagon.
She might know the most out of anybody.
When Chris is like, oh, you don't know about this and that. And then she asks, she's like, oh, are you asking if I know that the North ran him out of whatever, blah, blah, blah. Like, knew something that John Root didn't know.
Right,
you know,
exactly.
Among who knows what else. Yeah.
I definitely appreciate her performance quite a bit. Yeah. We've hit a lot of the hot spots. I mean, everyone dies at the end. I don't know what you say to that.
Poor OB.
Poor OB.
Yeah. Everybody does. So I guess you can feel good about that at least.
Right. Nobody does get redeemed.
Everyone got their comeuppance. So.
Yeah.
man. Shit.
I hope, you know, with Oppenheimer being as popular as well, maybe get a chance to get to see this on 70 mil again. I don't know if that'll ever happen again, but I would love to experience it that way again. Oh, this is the one thing I wanted to, you've seen now the film multiple times. Does it take anything away from you not seeing it in 70 mil, like seeing it in these other formats?
Yeah, no, for me, no.
Okay.
So, I mean, I still want to watch it on the biggest screen I can. And, and I've seen it a couple times, like on 35 in the theater. And even if it's not 70, even just being in a theater, like it still is.
Or it's framed correctly and everything. It's just not 70. Yeah.
It doesn't take it away from me at all. Not like, say, Avatar did. Like,
right.
That's a movie I've never seen again because I just like, well,
what's the point?
Yeah. This one, no.
Okay.
And like I mentioned, there's just something about it, like the characters,
so compelling.
The writing and the mix of like the humor with all these like bad and dirty, gritty ideas and things. But I love those dynamics. Again, like you put someone like Major Warren and Mannix like in a room together. What is that discussion? And I like seeing that. I like that that's being explored. And, you know, also, well, we also have to fit within the confines of the law. We can't just shoot each other right now. You know what I mean? Like, we can't necessarily
there's some
do
rules.
That. Yeah. I love all of that aspect of it. And yeah, it literally gets better, like just better and better. This might be, and again, I feel like every time I watch one of his movies, I say this, but watching this again, it might be my favorite film of his. I think it's a complete masterpiece.
It's definitely impressive, the filmmaking that's going on. I can pretty easily say it's not my favorite Quentin film, but I've liked all of his films. At some point we have to talk about Once Upon a Time in Hollywood, because you and I saw it together and we felt very differently about it. But that's the only one that didn't connect with me. But all of that, I am so glad you suggested this film because I got to reconnect with it again. I was like, wondering, why haven't I revisited this film? And damn, it's still so, like, there's just so many, it makes me want to watch it again because there are so many interesting points. It makes you want to analyze almost every word. Like, quite often, if you're into film and cinema and stuff, you want to study the frames and the scenes and things like that. This one, I want to study almost every word because the word, all the words have meaning to them, you know?
Yeah.
So just really masterful on that front.
It's amazing too, how his writing process, how like deep he gets into certain characters. Dude, for real. Like, again, like putting yourself in the shoes of like Mannix, right? And it's like, how do I turn this person into someone you can kind of, on a certain level, give empathize a shit about, with? And he talks a little bit in like his DGA interview with Chris Nolan when it came out about like the Daisy Domergue character, like hanging her at the end. Like, okay, is this going to be like super, is it super misogynistic? Is there some bias here? Like, how do I go?
Some
like,
critics called him out for it.
Yeah. And I love that he doesn't care about any of that shit. And I love how much he like bats against his whole political correctness. So I fucking love that. Like, him as an artist, go all the way. I absolutely love that. But that he took time and like, all right, I need to write a version of this, like all through her perspective. Like, who is she? What's her perspective on these events? Like, he said there was a draft where, like, I guess there was one where, you know, when she gets shot in the foot, where they killed her right then and there. Oh, and it was just like, that was it. And another one where, like, I think Mannix dies, but she lives. Like, he had like a bunch of different versions going. And it's interesting.
Him and some of the actors have talked about, she, you know, her character is a representation of what the South stood for and things like that. So this is like an indictment of, you know, the Southern way of living, you know, that this racism, all that. And I didn't personally pick up on that. But then again, I'm a person who lives in California. So like, I don't have a lot of those inherent things going on in my life. But that's the one thing you got to respect, that he forces you as an audience and as a viewer to confront these things. You can't look away. I am going to force you to sit there and watch this. Because he's not glorifying it. This is awful shit. And I agree with you that there's a definitely a level of respect I have for that.
Yeah.
Forcing the audience into, because some of basically our great directors always do that.
You know, yeah.
They put you in these positions where you can't look away. You have to confront it. You know?
And it's just, it's the truth of the character, right? Like, it would just be very cheap if, you know, that wasn't the case. It's like, do I like the fact that, you know, Major Marquez is calling out Bob for the whole sign on the door and comparing, oh, she started letting dogs in. Right. I don't like that, but that was the reality of America until like the 60s. Like, there's movies you can watch. I mean,
some would argue that's still happening today. So,
yeah,
you know,
very much. Yeah, very publicly with, you know, the former president. But like, as far as like that
moment,
blatant, like that was still going on not that long ago. We can even consider it today.
Yeah.
And that is like the truth, right? And like, I almost hate to see it because it's like, you don't want to see, like, you know, two people that are facing down, you know, like the barrel of like literally North America's gun. You know what I mean? Or that, I don't know, I suppose I put it right now. Like, I would always prefer to see those types of people come together. You know, I feel like we should be unified, but that is the truth of the characters in the world they live in. It's like kind of like what we talk about with Do the Right Thing, right? It's like, it's the truth of those characters. As much as it's a bummer,
we want them. Yeah.
It is the reality.
We want to see the after school special where these two shake hands, have a mug, go for a soda pop.
Yeah.
But no, that's just not the reality.
Yeah.
Shit, so.
But I still like, and with that being said, I still think it's, for me, like organic and works out that it does end up being him and Chris at the end, which I think is funny. And just even the fact too that I feel like Chris, maybe if he didn't almost drink the coffee, I believe he probably would have killed Sam Jackson, because really that's what it came down to. He's like, no deal.
Yeah.
And he's like, the fact is,
right?
I was about to drink that coffee and you didn't stop me. So like, now we're going to thank you. Like, really, he's still kind of selfish, which I think is super funny.
But that's like, true to his character, right?
Yeah,
like, I mean, he hasn't shown us anything different.
Like, he's thinking on such a surface level.
Yes, exactly. There's no depth there.
Or, my bet is that the ugliest sumbitch did it. And that's you, Joe Gage.
That's so fucking funny.
The ugliest still thinks. I love how he gets all like excited. Like, he's not even thinking anywhere near how Warren's thinking.
Not even half that level.
Shit, man. No, but yeah. Good. Dang. Great movie.
I'm glad I got to revisit it, man. It's been too long. So I appreciate you calling up this one.
Yeah. Dude, thanks for doing it. Well, shit. All right. Nelson Bros, go pick some up, try some.
And, we survived. We survived 8 different tastes.
Yeah. And I feel really good too.
Yeah, man. Feels great.
All right, man. Well, that's a wrap.
Cheers.
Cheers.